Greetings to all of you over there from Positive PG Medical Engineering Center and the entire OHC team. This is basically a discussion based on AIIMS May 2014 and the OHC 5 program, which was conducted in Chennai, which was a crash course basically framed for AIIMS and PGA May 2014. When we went into this AIIMS questions and the program materials, it was promises delivered. The number of questions which we assured which could be answered from OHC 5 program in May AIIMS 2014 was somewhere around 120 questions. And retrospectively, when we compared the questions and the program materials, it was approximately 120 questions were answered from various programs at OHC 5. So now, I'll just narrate all the programs which was in OHC 5 and the split up of questions which were covered in each of the program in AIIMS May 2014 exam. The first program here, first material was Operation Air Capsule book. This was a book which had four parts, which had one part which has exclusively the new points of the 18th edition of Harrison was one point. The second was an XPM extract, the third was physiology extract, and fourth was overall important points from various subjects were accumulated and given. This was the four parts of OHC book, and that book covered approximately 30 questions from AIIMS May 2014. The second was regarding Operation Harry book. Few words regarding this book. This book is being updated into the second edition, which will be coming shortly. It is completely updated. It is coming out in two volumes with appropriate pictures to make everything very clear. And we hope this book will leave a telling effect in the AIIMS November 2014 exam. This book answered approximately 60 questions plus. Posse goal is an accumulation of the last 5 years AIIMS. This had approximately 20 questions. Must know tables, it was heartening. It was an accumulation of salient tables from various subjects. Approximately 300 tables were there, which was made into the handout, and this covered approximately 15 questions. And then we analyzed the OHC class discussion and the AIIMS exam paper. The approximately 58 questions were discussed inside the program. Then we had the SPM program, ophthal program, forensic medicine, and the various other programs contributed approximately 25 questions. Overlaps will be there, so the total number of questions which were discussed at the various programs was approximately 120 questions. And suppose the AIIMS paper was compared with the entire positive MedPG regular course, then it was approximately 145 to 150 questions. Now, it is our turn to show the evidences to make it more authentic. So in each questions, I'll give you the question, the discussion, and the along with the exact the page number and from which material it has been taken to make the discussion more authentic. Now we'll start from one by one. The first, it is not subject based discussion. It is based on the materials and the exam questions. So the first evidence which we provide is Operation Harry book based. Now we'll go into the evidence number one, Operation Harry book. So we'll discuss the questions based on this book first. We'll start with the evidence one, Operation Harry book. So the first question which came from here was regarding a female who had severe itching. She scratched her upper limb and a wheel mark appeared and it persisted beyond half an hour. What is the probable diagnosis? The choices were dermatographic urticaria, acute urticaria, chronic urticaria, and pressure urticaria. Now coming to the discussion which was in that handout, urticaria, it is usually present with a non-pitting edema. It involves only the superficial portion of the dermis. Depending upon acute and chronic urticaria, by definition, acute urticaria is less than 6 weeks and chronic is beyond 6 weeks. The point which was relevant here for discussion was regarding dermatographism. Dermatographism occurs in 1 to 4% of normal population, predominantly in the second to third decade of life. It is, appears like a linear wheel at the site of stroke with a firm pressure. It is not influenced by any atopic diathesis. The catch here was regarding the duration. Regarding the duration, usually the so-called articular eruptions last for approximately 12 to 36 hours. But physical urticaria, namely cold, cholinergic and dermatographism, are an exception in which they last less than 2 hours. So the most common probable answer for this question might be your dermatographic urticaria, which lasts approximately in this case around half an hour. Few more questions which have been asked regarding urticaria in the examinations are: one, regarding cholinergic urticaria. It was asked in All India examination. These are wheels which are very small in size, 1 to 2 millimeter. It is precipitated by fever, a hot bath or shower or exercise. One more question asked regarding the same thing is called your aquagenic urticaria, which occurs in polycythemia vera. Some drugs which can cause urticaria, one is aspirin. Now we go to the next question. This was regarding criteria for brain death. This was an anticipated question because of a lot of cadaver program is going on. So this was an anticipated question as far as positive is concerned. Criteria of brain death, which is not included: absence of brainstem reflexes, loss of pain sensation to deep stimuli, positive apnea test, and loss of stretch reflexes. Regarding brain death is mainly thought of, it's a state of cessation of cerebral function with preservation of cardiac activity. Clinically, it will be in a patient who has a structurally irreversible CNS lesion, his heart is beating normally, who is ventilator dependent with vitals maintained. And in this patient, if all his brainstem reflexes are negative, and then the brain death is confirmed by a test called as apnea test. As we know, the most potent stimuli for your stimulating respiratory center is CO2. So the basis of apnea test is to raise your PCO2 up to 60, which is the threshold by which an intact respiratory center will work. If there is no spontaneous respiration even after PCO2 rises above 60, then it is positive apnea test, and for all practical purposes, this patient is declared brain dead. Brain death declaration is absolutely a bedside summary, so that EEG is not required to confirm brain death. Two doctors at a span of 6 hours minimum is required to certify brain death. The most important thing regarding brain death is it is just brain stem death. So the so-called spinal reflexes, your superficial reflexes might be preserved. So the answer in this question was your so-called your reflexes might be present. That is the answer in this question. Regarding the criteria for brain death, there are two criteria. The one which is currently utilized is called as Harvard's criteria. The second is your UK criteria for diagnosis of brain death. Now we'll go to the next question. This question was regarding a boy with a right-sided facial hemangioma with opposite side intracranial calcification. What could be the diagnosis? It's a repeat one. The choices were Struge-Weber and von Hippel-Lindau. The answer here was Struge-Weber syndrome. Struge-Weber syndrome is a syndrome which we know is characterized by facial hemangioma with intracranial calcification, which characteristically is called as tram track calcification. So the answer here was Struge-Weber syndrome. The next question was regarding a 5-year-old male presents with thrombocytopenia, neutrophil count was elevated, peripheral smear shows myelocyte, metamyelocyte, with bone marrow blast 12%, translocation 821, what is the probable diagnosis? Choices were MDS, CML, AML and CLL. Among these choices, this question is little, the discussion regarding this question revolves around two things: one regarding the translocation 821 and regarding the percentage of blast. Translocation 821 is commonly associated with your acute myeloid leukemia. But the percentage of blast cell, which is 12%, is away from the diagnosis of leukemia. According to your WHO classification, 20% and above is called as your so-called leukemia. Below that, it becomes your MDS, it might be your MDS. So the answer here might be narrowed down to your myelodysplastic syndromes. We'll see some discussions regarding both AML and your MDS. MDS is usually a disorder of elderly. There are five types. Entrance wise, the most important point is the commonest type among your MDS is your RAEB type 1. That is called as your refractory anemia with excessive blast type 2 is the one which has maximum number of blast, approximately 15%. But overall, the commonest type will be your RAEB type 1 is the commonest one. And regarding the other points regarding MDS, the common age group is approximately 68. It usually presents with pancytopenia and with anemia which is not responding to conventional therapy. The chromosomes usually associated with MDS are trisomy 8, loss of 5, 7 or 20, monosomy. These are the things which are commonly associated with your MDS. A syndrome which can predispose to MDS is your Down syndrome. And now we'll go into the other topic which was to be discussed here is your acute myeloid leukemia. AML syndromes associated with AML are Klinefelter syndrome, Patau syndrome and Down syndrome. And the other defective DNA repair mechanisms like Bloom's, Fanconi's also might be associated with your AML. One more thing, paroxysmal PNH and your congenital neutropenia called as Coastman syndrome can also predispose to acute myeloid leukemia. AML, most importantly, the translocation is commonly associated with your 821. The recent classification of AML has undergone drastic change, which was classified as in 2008. It has so many things. The genetic abnormalities commonly associated with AML are T821 and with inversion 16. These are the common things associated with your AML. Then there's your FAB classification regarding M0 to M7. M6 is called as erythroleukemia or Daguerreau-Lumas disease. The commonest AML among your M0 to M7 is M2. It is your myeloblastic leukemia with maturation 30%. The rarest type is M7, which is 1%. And now we'll go into the next question. A surgery was done for a cauliflower-like growth in right colon. Diagnosed as adenocarcinoma, which mutation is not seen in this patient? Options were KRAS, CMYC, microsatellite instability and EFGR. And these are the four options in that. If we go by the text which is given here, KRAS occurs in approximately 50% of colonic carcinomas and 85% of your CA pancreas. Microsatellite instability is associated with your CA colon. The only thing is it doesn't carry a bad prognosis. Coming to the other two options, CMYC and EFGR, we'll see the discussion. So the genetics involved in your colonic carcinoma predominantly are APC gene, KRAS gene and DCC gene and your P53 gene. All these are the genes associated with your so-called colonic carcinoma. Microsatellite instability is also associated here. Coming to the point mutation, KRAS we saw already 85% in CA pancreas, 50% in CA colon. The DCC gene is called as deleted in colorectal cancer gene. This is also associated with your CA colon. Coming to the various other oncogenes and the concerned human cancers, what we are oriented is CMYC gene. There are four malignancies which are associated with your CMYC gene. They are CA breast, colon, gastric and lung carcinoma. These are the four malignancies which are associated with your CMYC. The last option which is left, which was your EFGR. EFGR, the wild type EFGR is expressed by many other cancers and in colonic cancer and head and neck cancers. This is the rationale of targeting those tumors with EFGR antagonists with a monoclonal antibody called as cetuximab. This was asked in All India 2009. So if you want to be very precise regarding this question, which mutation is not seen? KRAS is seen, CMYC is seen, EFGR is seen, microsatellite instability is associated. This question is ambiguous. Coming to the next question regarding puff of smoke appearance occurs in which condition? This was a straightforward question. Answer was Moyamoya disease. There is few discussion regarding Moyamoya disease. It's an occlusive disease involving large intracranial arthritis. Unfortunately, it is a disease of children or young adults presents with accelerated hypertension and IC bleed. The typical vascular angio appearance is called as your puff of smoke appearance. Coming to the next question in this program, it is all these are diseases due to uniparental disomy except. This was a straight repeat from your AIIMS November 2013 session. The choices were Prader-Willi, Angelman syndrome, Russell syndrome and Bloom syndrome. Prader-Willi, Angelman, Russell are disorders of your so-called your uniparental disomy except Bloom syndrome, which comes under your disorder of your defective DNA repair, which comes under your DNA repair mechanism disorder. It's a Bloom syndrome. Next, we will come into your other question, which is regarding a baby is handled by a caregiver. Which infection can be transmitted commonly? The choices were Candida albicans, Candida glabrata, Candida tropicalis, and Candida parapsilosis. So, we will see the discussion which was given in the book. The causative organism regarding candida infection is commonly, no doubt, it is your Candida albicans, but may also be caused by the other species, Cruci, glabrata and tropicalis. The most therapeutic point regarding the other two organisms regarding C. cruci and C. glabrata are the increased incidence of resistance to therapy. Coming to the other discussion, which might, the answer here might be Candida albicans, but the one thing which was given here is regarding your non-albicans species is approximately seen in 50% of candidemia. So if it is given as candidemia, then you might go for a non-albicans species. But if nothing of that sort is given, then your answer might be straightforward, it is your Candida albicans. Some points regarding Candida albicans, it can produce something called as satellite pustules. And there is one more thing which it might be asked in the exams, it is called as the id reaction. Id reaction is a hypersensitive reaction to the fungal antigen, in which if the prime it is present in this few distance away from the routine infection, it is because of a hypersensitive reaction. The antigen is not present in the concerned lesion. Coming to the next question, it was regarding a patient with acute bacterial meningitis. What is the treatment of choice? Choices were ceftriaxone, sulfamethoxol, streptomycin and erythromycin. It was a simple one. The answer straightforward became ceftriaxone. Few other points regarding ceftriaxone. This becomes the drug of choice for your list. This is also utilized in your listeriosis. And it can be used for penicillin sensitive gonorrhea. Coming to the next question regarding bull neck appearance is seen in which of the following condition? Choices were diphtheria, tuberculosis, goiter and gout. It was a straightforward simple answer. The answer is diphtheria. The complications, the most worrying complication which can occur is diphtheria myocarditis, which comes in the second or third week with a high degree of mortality. The next question asked, it was a pictorial based questions, around 5 to 6 questions were picture based questions. A child presented with an infection, the urine analysis revealed a cell which showed an ulcer appearance, what could be the probable cause? The choices were CMV and HSV, the answer became cytomegalovirus. It is called as megalovirus because of the large inclusion bodies in the tissues. The drugs which are used for cytomegaloviruses are your ganciclovir. The only disadvantage regarding ganciclovir is a low oral bioavailability. This has been circumvented by the new drug called as valganciclovir. The one point regarding this, the other drug which is called as foscarnet, which is utilized in your CMV, is toxic, renotoxic. The next question is regarding a one-year-old girl presenting with headache, vomiting and fever. She was treated for viral infection. Later, she developed cerebral edema and was admitted. What is the expected change in the liver biopsy specimen? It's a very good, practical, well-thought question. The choices were ring granuloma, centrilobar liver necrosis, NASH, and microvesicular steatosis. Summarizing the history, this child is suffering from Reye syndrome. The points for are fever, vomiting, which suggests signs of raised ICT, following a viral prodrome, there is cerebral edema. And so this patient, if you do a liver biopsy, the anticipated finding in this individual is microvesicular fatty steatosis. Coming to microvesicular fatty steatosis, there are few conditions which are associated with this microvesicular fatty steatosis. The mnemonic is Raj TV. It is your Ray syndrome, acute fat liver pregnancy, drugs, toxins, and phosphorus and outdated tetracycline all comes under your so-called your Raj TV, which is your microvesicular steatosis. So the answer here became your microvesicular steatosis. The next question was regarding painful vesicle in T3 dermatome. What is the diagnosis? This again was a repeat one. Choices were herpes zoster, varicella zoster, herpes simplex infection. This becomes your varicella zoster. Some points regarding varicella zoster. This commonly occurs in 6th decade of life. The common dermatome involved are from T3 to L3. In children, reactivation is usually benign. In adults, if it is reactivated, it is fulminant. This also can be associated with something called as Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, which is a genicular ganglion of the sensory branch of the facial nerve is involved. With the vesicles around the external auditory canal, loss of taste in the anterior to the tongue. This is your Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. So this answer was herpes zoster. Coming to the circumcorneal vascularization is seen in the deficiency of which vitamin? This again is a repeat one. The choices were thiamine, biotin, riboflavin and vitamin D. The answer here was your vitamin B2, it's a riboflavin. So the choice, some points regard, I just want you to focus regarding the amount of vitamin which is required for per day consumption. It is approximately 0.3 to 0.6 milligram per 1000 kilocalories for thiamine and riboflavin. Some points regarding niacin. Currently, niacin is present in various food substances. So, dietary deficiency of pellagra is little uncommon. Currently, the two common causes of pellagra are, one, it is your Hartnup disease. Second, it is your, first is your Hartnup disease. Second is a carcinoid. These are the two diseases. Suppose a patient comes with Castle necklace appearance. Now, he should immediately rule out these two conditions. Coming to the functions of various, and I summarized the functions of various vitamins B1, B2, niacin, B6, folate and B12. So these are the various things which have been here. And coming to vitamin B12, it's a coenzyme for your methyl melanoyl CoA reaction. Fatty, your fat soluble vitamins A is predominantly taking part in your Wall's visual cycle. Vitamin B12, some points, it comes under your flavoenzymes. The lesions are, it can produce mucocutaneous lesions, corneal vascularization, anemia, and sometimes personality changes. The one good thing regarding vitamin B2 is, even if you ingest a large amount, it will not produce toxicity. Coming to the next question was again regarding cytomegalovirus. A HIV positive patient, CD4 count less than 100, what is the cause of the organ showing intracerebroplasmic inclusions with a perinuclear harrow? This again was explaining regarding CMV, so the answer here became CMV. Some points regarding the table which is occurring regarding CMV and your HIV, usually below 100, two organisms comes in. One is CMV, second is your Mycobacterium avium intracellularic thing. But CMV below 50, it is usually CMV retinitis. So 100 to 50, it might be a CMV infection. Good. Next question was in nephrology. A 4-year-old child with frothy urine, oliguria, proteinuria, serum creatinine 0.5, albumin 2.5, no RBC cast. What is the diagnosis? Here, there are a few points which is given here which can point to the diagnosis. There is no RBC cast. So it is not, and with a normal creatinine, it is not a rapidly progressive GN. So the other points which if it be put together, no RBC cast, frothy urine, urine albumin 3+, albumin less than 2.5, then it boils down to your minimal chain disease. The answer for this is your minimal chain disease. which contains predominantly albuminuria, hypoalbuminemia, and a normal creatinine? The answer here is minimal change disease. This next question was regarding a 6-year-old malnourished girl came to the OP with complaints of weakness. HB was just 4.6 grams. She had an erythematous eruptions and swelling in the ankle and knee. What is the most likely organism? Here, the answer will become your hookworm, because hookworm, some points regarding hookworm. Hookworm can cause something called as ground itch. What is that? It is the dermatological lesion at the site of the skin penetration. It is called as a ground itch. There are two hookworm specimens, species. One is Ankylostoma duodenale and one is your Nectar americanus. So please note, regarding the lifespan, the americanus duodenalis lives for a longer lifespan comparing your Nectar americanus. Good. The next question is, pseudomembrane of the tonsil and gram stain was done. What is the possible organism will be? Before coming to the answer proper, the clinical scenario with the pseudomembrane in the tonsils and gram stain might narrow it down to diphtheria. Some points regarding a diphtheria. Diphtheria, it has pseudomembrane lesion which is in the tonsillopharyngeal region. Pseudomembrane means if it is peeled out, it lead to bleeding points. So if it is diphtheria, then it becomes a gram positive bacilli. Coming to the next question regarding MRI section of midbrain, brainstem, it was a brainstem section and a history was given, and the question was, which among the following discussion is not a part of the picture above. The picture above, if you want to take it from the choices, then the question what they are asking is regarding lateral medullary syndrome. If it is lateral medullary syndrome, then loss of pain on temperature on opposite side occurs, nystagmus occurs because cerebellum is involved, and there is palatal palsy because of the 9th, 10th and 11th nerve are also involved in your so-called your pica. But ipsilateral tongue paralysis occurs in a condition called as your medial lateral medullary syndrome. So in all probabilities, C is the answer. Good. And now coming to the next one regarding HELLP syndrome, which is not there in HELLP syndrome. Hemolysis, increased liver enzymes, thrombocytopenia, and retroplacental bleed. We had discussed already, we say regarding HELLP syndrome, the expansion is hemolysis, it's your low platelets and your liver enzymes are elevated. So the answer here becomes your retroplacental bleed. Some points regarding your HELLP syndrome. HELLP syndrome is a fulminant form of your pre-eclampsia. Good. The common drugs which can be given safely during pregnancy with hypertension are labetalol, hydralazine, calcium blockers. To avoid are AC inhibitors and ARBs are to be avoided. Next question was regarding a marker of multiple myeloma, which is not a marker of multiple myeloma. The choices were M spike, increased IgG, osteolytic lesions and ANA. Regarding some point, the answer here is D, it is your ANA. Some points regarding multiple myeloma, the classification diagnostic criteria for solvent multiple myeloma is named after a person called as Dury and Salmon. There are two criteria, one major criteria which has various subdivisions. One is called as minor criteria, which also has its subdivision. But if you go through the discussion proper, what is required for the diagnosis? It requires one major plus one minor or three minor criteria to confirm and diagnose your so-called multiple myeloma with confidence. It is one major plus one minor or three minor criteria is for diagnosing your multiple myeloma. Now we'll go to the next question. It is regarding a neurogenic shock is characterized by. Choices were bradycardia, hypotension, tachycardia, bradycardia and hypotension, tachycardia and hypertension. Coming to neurogenic shock, some points. Regarding your any shock, cardiac tissue acts by three mechanisms. One, ventricular filling. Second, mitral contractility. These two are the things which are common for your shock in your so-called neurogenic shock. It's called as pyro. What is pyro? Predisposition, infection, response, organ dysfunction. It is called as pyro. Pyro is also regarding a shock, which is the new thing regarding shock. And one more thing which I want to share is the specific biomarker which is associated with septicemia is your IL-6. A recent drug which is going on clinical trial for shock is called as a small molecule which is an endotoxin antagonist. It is called as Eritotan. Might be asked in the exams. Eritotan is a new drug which is being tried for your therapy for your shock. One more point regarding entrance and your shock. Majority of hormones in shock are increased. Exception is insulin, which is decreased. This was a question regarding a 300-year-old boy with a rash, strawberry tongue, mucocutaneous lymphadenopathy, and 6 days of fever. What is the possible diagnosis? Choices were scarlet fever, Kawasaki, Kimura, and Rosai-Doffman syndrome. The answer here is more closely towards your Kawasaki disease. Kawasaki is a common disease in West which usually occurs below 5 years. The one notorious complication of Kawasaki we know is your coronary aneurysm. And it will have your strawberry tongue, mucocutaneous lymphadenopathy and a descomedic rash which might occur in your Kawasaki. Kawasaki, one more point, it's one vasculitis which is, it comes under your medium size vasculitis, and it is one condition which is associated with your thrombocytosis is your Kawasaki's disease. The most notorious complication is your so-called coronary aneurysm, which might be prevented by your giving your immunoglobulins. Next question was regarding father and son had similar skin lesions. Other sibling and the mother are normal who lived somewhere apart. What is the mode of your inheritance? It is autosomal dominant, recessive and X-linked recessive. Next was regarding 2 months after renal transplant, what is the most common viral infection? Choices were polyoma, CMV, HSV and herpes simplex. There should be no confusion regarding post-transplant infections and the concerned organism. Post-transplant infection can be classified into 0 to 1 year, 1 month, 1 to 6 months and 6 months onwards. 0 to 1 month, it is like any other infection, it is predominantly your pneumonia or UTI. Beyond 1 month to 6 months, it is commonly viral infections. That too, it is predominantly CMV infection. It is your CMV infection. CMV, we saw the drug choice is your valganciclovir. It is your CMV infection. The next question was regarding fatty stimuli leading to gallbladder contraction is mediated primarily by which hormone? CCK, gastrin, secretin and GLP. The answer here was CCK. CCK, what is the source? It is from your mucosa of the upper small intestine. 2 points, it can be macro heterogeneous or micro heterogeneous. The entrance point regarding CCK is your CCK has a very short half-life of just 5 minutes. It is your CCK. Functions of CCK, predominantly 2 or 3 important functions you should know. First is, it stimulates pancreatic enzyme secretion. It can cause your gallbladder to contract and simultaneously it relaxes your sphincter of body. So these are the functions of your so-called CCK. Now we'll go into the next question. The next question regarding the, in a girl regarding puberty, which is true? The choices were, hypothalamic pituitary axis has sensitivity to estrogen. Pulsatile release of GnRH occurs in the night. Increased concentration of estrogen, adrenal androgens decrease. What is the answer here? We'll go one by one. Regarding your adrenal androgens usually are increased during puberty. The next point is regarding increased concentration of estrogen. This might be the answer there. This is also not true. Please note, it is also not true. It is not increased concentration of estrogen. Regarding pulsatile release of GnRH occurs in the night, it might be true till pre-pubertal region. Once the patient attains puberty, this pulsatile release of GnRH occurs throughout the day. That was the catch which was kept in this question. Regarding hypothalamic pituitary axis, it has sensitivity to your estrogen. Coming to the next question, which was asked regarding Janani Shishu Suraksha Karyakram. It's a new program. It is your JSSY. Charges were cash incentive for insurance delivery, free medical care for children up to 1 year in all healthcare facilities, provision of food to mother, dropping of mother and child to her home from the site of your health care. If you go by the discussion detail, the answer in your JSSK becomes cash initiative for your institutional deliveries. In this program, Janani Shishu Suraksha Karyakram, it's a program which is a new one initiative to make available better health facilities for women and children. All pregnant women delivering in public institutions are given absolutely free and no expense for delivery, including section. Free drugs and consumables and free diet up to 3 days for normal deliveries and 7 days for section is given here. Free transport from home and back home is provided, and similar entitlements for sick newborns for accessing public health institutions for treatment for 30 days after birth is provided in this program. What is not here is your cash incentive for insulin delivery. That is covered under a program called as Janani Suraksha Yojana, which is targeted mainly to promote insulin deliveries. In this, the mother's package will be approximately 700 to 1400. It has been raised. So please, this is the program in which there is a cash incentive for insulin deliveries. The answer here was cash incentive for your insulin delivery. The next question is regarding positive predictive value indicates sensitivity, specificity, and what is the next point. Choices were prevalence, incidence, relative risk, absolute risk. It was heartening to note that the same sentence was in this textbook. We'll see the discussion here. Regarding the screening test, we know regarding true positive, false negative, and true negative. The sensitivity and specificity. What is sensitivity? Is the ability to test, to detect the disease when it is present. Coming to a positive predictive value, it is a proportion of test positive who actually have the disease. The formula for positive predictive value is A by A plus B. Positive predictive value, it's a function of sensitivity, specificity, and prevalence. So the answer here was prevalence. Coming to the next question is regarding viper venom. Is vascotoxic, neurotoxic, histotoxic, and myotoxic? This was an easy one. The answer, viper is predominantly a hemotoxic one. Some points regarding poisonous snakes. They belong to your viperidae, elaphidae, and hydrophidae. In viper and pit, in your pit viper, the teeth are long ones, which are viper or having a triangular head. They are predominantly hemotoxic. Snake venoms are complex enzymes. They have enzymes, they have glycoproteins and metal ions. Neurotoxic snakes are crates, a cobras, and Indian Russell viper is neurotoxic. In general, vipers are predominantly hemotoxic, but Indian Russell viper goes into a neurotoxic snake. Sea snake is predominantly myotoxic. Some entrance oriented points regarding snake bite and its toxin. One is regarding what is to be done once the snake bites the person regarding immobilization. The point I want to stress is regarding the wrap pressure must be precise. It is required only for neurotoxic snake. The wrap pressure is 40 to 70 millimeter of mercury in the upper extremity, and in the lower extremity it becomes somewhere around 55 to 70 millimeter. The next point I want to stress regarding your entrance thing, for a muscle compartment syndrome which might occur following a myotoxic snake, there is something called as intracompartmental pressure. When the ICP exceeds 30 mm of mercury, then it needs fasciotomy. The next point I want to stress regarding entrance exams and poisons are regarding the lethal dose. Coming to the lethal dose, at least one thing you should know regarding common cobra. The lethal dose of common cobra is approximately 0.4 milligram per kg. For your common crate, it is 0.09 milligram per kg. The next question is regarding which among the following ATT will cause hypothyroidism: rifampicin, pyrazinamide, streptomycin, and ethionamide. Two things regarding ATT and hypothyroidism. Two ATT drugs can cause hypothyroidism. One, it is your ethionamide. Second, it is your para-aminosalicylic acid, which is obsolete now. Now we'll see some points regarding ethionamide. This was discussed in this page 729. Some points regarding ethionamide which I want to stress. It is like INH and pyrazinamide. It's a derivative of isonicotinic acid. It is bacteriostatic. Toxicity, two things are there. It can cause hepatitis and hypothyroidism. The one good thing regarding ethionamide, it has got a good CSF penetration. It is predominantly useful in MDRD, MDR tuberculosis. PAS, it also can cause hypothyroidism. It has a poor CNS penetration. It has a half-life of just 1 hour. The ATT, which has got the highest hypersensitive reaction, fatal hypersensitive reaction in dermis, like your, it can cause toxic epidermonecrolysis, is thiazidazone. The next question, one ATT which can cause peripheral neuropathy apart from INH is cycloserine. Cycloserine can cause toxicity like INH. It can cause psychosis, seizures, and peripheral neuropathy. Now we'll go to the next question regarding time-dependent killing and prolonged antibiotic effect is seen in. This is a repeat one which was asked already in your AIIMS May 2013. The choices were quinolones, clindamycin, erythromycin, and beta-lactams. The discussion which was in this textbook goes like this. Antibiotics can be classed into two things: either concentration dependent technique, dependent method. The drugs which comes under that is fluoroquinolones and aminoglycosides. And second is called as time dependent bacterial killing, that is your beta-lactams. So as far as this text is concerned, the answer here becomes your beta-lactams. The next question we'll be discussing is pemetrexed toxicity is decreased by. When we went into this question and when we went back to our textbook, it was very, very heartening because the same combination was given in our bright spot in our textbook. The choices were folic acid and pyridoxine, folic acid and B12, folic acid and pyridoxine. We'll directly go to the choice pemetrexed. Pemetrexed, it is coming under the toxicity which is commonly in pemetrexed or anemia, neutropenia, and thrombocytopenia. It can cause pancytopenia. How do you avoid that? Supplement folate and B12. It was given as a small thing. Supplement folate and B12. It should be given with caution in renal failure. It is pemetrexed. So please note the answer becomes folic acid and B12. Coming to the other things which has been. One more thing which I want to stress here, as we have seen regarding hypothyroidism in ATT, the one anti-cancer drug which can cause hypothyroidism is bexarotene. Bexarotene can cause central hypothyroidism. The one more drug which might be asked in the exams regarding cancer chemotherapy drugs which can cause hand-foot syndrome is sorafenib. And now we'll go into the next question. Peripheral vasospasm is caused by which anti-Parkinson's drug? Ropinirole, levodopa, bromocriptine. We know the drug of choice for your anti-Parkinson's drug is levodopa. Coming to the drug which can be given, or it is predominantly dopamine agonist, the next group is ergot derivatives. In ergot derivatives, we have bromocriptine, pergolide, and cabergoline. The choice given here was bromocriptine. Since it beats an ergot derivative, it can cause vasospasm. The question which has been already asked in the recent examinations regarding your anti-Parkinson drug is rotigotine. Rotigotine was asked in AIIMS November 2011, a drug which can be given as a transdermal patch. The one more question regarding therapy for Parkinsonism, which was asked in All India 2012, was regarding DBS, deep brain stimuli. Where do you put in the electrode? It became your subthalamic nuclei. Coming to the next question, emergency intravenous antihypertensive in pregnancy are all except sodium nitroprusside, dihydralazine, diazoxide, labetalol. Labetalol, sodium nitroprusside, and dihydralazine can be given except your diazoxide. to our drugs in pregnancy which are safe, labetalol, hydralazine and calcium channel blockers, to the antihypertensives to be avoided are ACE inhibitors and ARBs because they can cause fetal renal dysfunction. Coming to the next question, furosemide acts on which area of the nephron? It was a simple straightforward one. It is your thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. Coming to the next question, in acute inflammation, which is false, it was a fascinating question here. The choices were VCAM and ICAM are involved in addition. Margination is by selectin. PCAM and BAR-CD31 is for neutrophil activation. Chemotaxis is by complement mediators. We'll go one by one regarding all this or the inflammatory mediators which takes part in your inflammation. We directly go into one, your so-called VCAM. The expansion for VCAM is vascular cell adhesion protein. It's also called as vascular cell adhesion molecule 1. So VCAM take and ICAM are involved in adhesion. The next choice we will see regarding PCAM CD31. This was given in the page 269 in this textbook. Regarding PCAM and your CD31, the process of migration into the tissues called as diapedesis. Diapedesis is the process in which PCAM and CD31 takes part. Coming to your selectin, it can be three types of selectins. Selectins are glycoproteins expressed on neutrophils and endothelial cells. They are the one which makes the cell, the flow of the RBCs to come to the periphery so that they come and stick to your vessel. So if you go with the discussion here, your P-selectin and E-selectin, the major role is in rolling and addition. Please note, P-selectin takes part in rolling and E-selectin takes part in rolling and addition. Your ICAM predominantly additions and VCAM also predominantly your addition. So if you go by this discussion, so the answer in this question is this. Coming to the next question, which is not of IgE? It is a straightforward simple one. The choices were Crossus placenta, it is used in infection, most important mediator of allergic hypersensitivity and mast cell degradation. And the answer is, it doesn't cross placenta, answer is A. Some more points I want to stress regarding IgE. The half-life of IgE is 2.5 days. Among the all antibodies, this is the one which has the least concentration, it is approximately 0.0003. The next question which we saw is HIV virus was isolated in. Choices were 1983, 1984, 1969. It was heartening to know that. Some history regarding HIV. AIDS first diagnosed in 1981. 1983 HIV was first. Some point regarding the HIV history. AIDS first recognized in 1981. 1983 HIV was isolated from patient with lymphadenopathy. 84, it was demonstrated to be the causative agent of AIDS. ELISA came into practice in 1985. Some more points regarding infectious agents and the recent one. I just want to say a few points. Hepatitis C virus was first discovered in 1989. SARS came into 2003. Next question, 19-year-old patient with comedone with acne and pustular lesions, what is the management? Topical isotretinoin and doxy, topical retinoin, clindamycin, these are the choices there. Comedone, acne and pustular lesions are a form of a fulminant acne vulgaris. This occurs in 10-20%. The etiology is your propionibacterium acne. Some points regarding acne and exams. Drugs which can cause acneiform eruptions are steroids, OC pills, lithium, INH, phenytoin and phenobarbital. Treatment is predominantly benzoyl peroxide gel, salicylic acid or retinoic acid. Topical antibacterial agents like azelaic acids and topical erythromycin might also be tried. Patients with moderate to severe acne can be treated with tetracycline, doxy and minocycline. If the female patients who do not respond to oral antibiotics, you might try a hormonal therapy in the form of ethinyl estradiol or norgestromate. For patients with severe nodulocystic acne, it is synthetic retinoid, isotretinoin. The only problem is it can produce multiple adverse effects like hypertriglyceridemia. One more point regarding acne and exams. Just I want to stress regarding acne, rosacea. Most importantly, it will not be associated with comedones. It will have some erythema and dilated vessels. Next question is regarding a patient with nail pitting and onycholysis is associated with. Choices were cicatrical alopecia, bilaceous plaque and scaly plaque. The thing which is being discussed here is pertaining to psoriasis. Nail pitting is characteristic of psoriasis. Onycholysis also occurs in psoriasis. So the typical skin lesion which is seen in psoriasis is a scaly plaque. The clinical signs in psoriasis we know is Aspid sign and Koebner's phenomenon. The next question was asked regarding alopecia areata, which is the wrong comment, which is the wrong answer. Choices were exclamation mark, geographic tongue and pitted nails. Alopecia areata is one form of areata alopecia which will produce a non-scarring alopecia which is characterized by exclamation mark and pitted nails. Geographic tongue does not occur in alopecia areata. The next question was, which has been asked in the exam, was regarding a child with flat topped violaceous papules. On histopathological examination, what is the provisional finding? Flat topped violaceous papules is typical of your lichen planus. So the question is, which is the histopathological finding of lichen planus? Choices were basal cell degeneration, acantholytic cell and suprabasal split. Regarding this findings, the HPE findings of lichen planus has been asked many times in the examinations. It has been asked in 2006 in two contexts. One was regarding Max Joseph space and civetti bodies or colloid bodies. Both occurs in your lichen planus. The other findings are hypergranulosis, irregular acanthosis, and most importantly, what we are worried is your basal cell degeneration is typical of your lichen planus. Regarding your granular layer, it is increased in lichen planus. There is hypogranulosis in psoriasis. The clinical finding in lichen planus, one is Wickham striae and lazy appearance in your oral mucosa. The next question is regarding superimposed preeclampsia in a patient with pre-existing chronic hypertension is detected by all except new onset proteinuria, fresh changes in the fundus, increase in systolic blood pressure of more than 30 and diastolic more than 15 and platelet count less than 75,000. Question is regarding superimposed preeclampsia in a patient who is already hypertensive. New onset proteinuria, fresh changes in the fundus, and increase in BP more than 30 and diastolic pressure more than 15 all points towards preeclampsia in an underlying hypertensive individual. But coming to the last choice, which is thrombocytopenia. Thrombocytopenia is a point which suggests severe preeclampsia. The points favoring severe preeclampsia are CNS dysfunction, proteinuria more than 5 gram, oliguria or renal failure, pulmonary edema and thrombocytopenia. So the answer here becomes thrombocytopenia. The next question was regarding a young girl with multinodular goiter, which is a wrong statement. The first choice was, if nodule is more than 1 centimeter, always do FNAC. If nodule is more than 4 centimeter, always should be removed. Functional nodule is usually benign. Technetium 99 can differentiate hypo from hyperthyroidism. Choice 1 is true. Any nodule more than 1 centimeter warrants an FNAC. Functional nodule is usually benign and your technetium scan can differentiate hyperthyroidism from hypothyroidism. More than 4 centimeter need not be always surgically removed. Next question was regarding 2-year-old child with medulloblastoma presents with an expanding hydrocephalus, which is not a rational step in the management. Shunt surgery, craniotomy and removal of tumor, but rim of tissue surrounding facial colliculus was left behind by surgeon. CCNU and vincristine was given. Cranial irradiation of 35 grays to 50 grays is being tried, which is not the option. The thing which has been given in our text regarding medulloblastoma and therapy, the treatment involves maximal surgical resection, craniospinal irradiation and chemotherapy with agents including cisplatin, lomustine, cyclophosphamide and vincristine. So the answer here becomes this. Next question was regarding 10-year-old boy presented with fever and swelling in left tibia in the diaphyseal region. ESR is increased, the provisional diagnosis. Chondrosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma, osteosarcoma and osteochondroma. Among the choices here, the one which predominantly involves diaphysis becomes Ewing sarcoma, and Ewing sarcoma can mimic an acute osteomyelitis with fever and swelling in the left tibial region. So the answer here becomes Ewing sarcoma. In the translocation associated with Ewing sarcoma is T1122. The next one was regarding ANCA positive vasculitis. Answer is vaginous granulomatosis. There are two types of ANCA we know. It is C ANCA and P ANCA. C ANCA is seen in your vaginous disease. P ANCA is seen in the two other diseases like your microscopic polyangiitis, and its next disease is Churg-Strauss. These are the three diseases which are associated with your ANCA. C ANCA in vaginous disease. P ANCA is seen in your microscopic pan and your Churg-Strauss disease. So far we have seen a discussion of AIIMS May 2014 in relevance to the OHC 5 program. At this juncture, there are a few acknowledgements and congratulations. At the onset, the entire OHC 5 team and positive team congratulates all the toppers in AIIMS May 2014. Acknowledgements. On the day of the exam, we had a discussion after the exam. This entire questions were possible because of these doctors who came for the discussion, and the discussion went on as late as 11:30 p.m. So I just want to acknowledge all those who made it possible. Dr. Raj Rahman, Dr. B. Srinath, Dr. M. Srinivas, Dr. Vimaladithan, Dr. Ambuja Shekhar, Dr. Priya, Dr. Santosh Kumar from Madurai, all others from Chennai, and Dr. Venkat Raj, all these doctors who made it possible. Thanks a lot. And now, we have seen the evidence from OHC 5. I have given it in black and white, the evidence with page number, approximately 120 questions from AIIMS May 2014 has been discussed at various programs at OHC 5. This, to translate into ranks, should be utilized completely by the candidates. This is what we try to do in those 12 days inside OHC 5 to make you utilize the OHC 5 materials completely. So this time we have tried to make some more amendments and some more improvements. First, regarding Operation Harry book, few points. It is completely updated. It is made into two volumes. It has been supplemented with apt and appropriate pictures to make it everything worthwhile. What does it plan? It plans to cover 90 to 100 questions at least from AIIMS November 2014. This will be available by late June. Operation Harry book, two volumes, plus OHC book, one volume, what we call it as OHC combo, will try to cover at least 120 questions from AIIMS November 2014. So, what is ideal to make it, make the evidence to translate into ranks? If you come reasonably prepared with these OHC Operation Harry book two volumes plus OHC book one volume, not completely oriented, at least reasonably oriented to OHC 6, then the evidences will definitely translate into ranks. So thanks a lot for your patient audience. If what we request is done, OHC 6 evidences will definitely translate into ranks. Thanks a lot again. We'll meet at OHC 6. Thank you guys.